I was just wondering, maybe we should start. It is 15 minutes in, just so we don't waste the time of the people who came on time.
I agree. It's just we're setting up a live stream. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. I would like to welcome everyone who's here today for our second annual pre-med conference. This is the second time the Ahmadiyya Muslim Medical Association of Canada has been doing this. I'd like to welcome everyone who is joining us on live stream across the country and those who have joined us here today. My name is Dr. Kashif Ahmed. I am the president of the Ahmadiyya Muslim Medical Association. Some of you may be familiar with our presentation last year. You know, it was the first time we did this, and this is the second time. We don't have the same presentation, so we're bringing something new for you today. And the intention of today's presentation is really not just to guide people, because you can get a lot of this information off of the internet. It's really to motivate you to consider post-secondary education, to consider medicine as one of the many careers you can choose after you finish your undergraduate degree. And also to introduce you to people who are in the Jamaat, who are young physicians or currently in training, so you can reach out to us as mentors. So that's actually the main reason we're doing this. Right now, here in Thayer Hall in Vaughan, we have a few people who are here, but I got a lot of emails from people who said that they will be joining us across the country, and they also said that they would be interested in watching this once we record this and leave this as an archive on YouTube. So I would like to start first by reciting from the Quran, and then afterwards I'll introduce our speakers, or I'll have the speakers introduce themselves, and then we'll begin. And I would like to apologize for those who are waiting for the live stream to come on. There was just some technical issues, so thank you for your patience. أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ كنتم خير أمة أخرجت للناس تأمرون بالمعروف وتنهون عن المنكر وتؤمنون بالله ولو آمن أهل الكتاب لكان خيرا لهم منهم المؤمنون وأكثرهم الفاسقون. This is from chapter 3, Al-Imran, verse 111. The translation is, you are the best people raised for the good of mankind. You enjoin what is good and forbid evil, and believe in Allah. And if the people of the book had believed, it would have surely been better for them. Some of them are believers, but most of them are disobedient. The first part of that verse outlines the expectations that Allah has for Muslims. And Hazrat Masih Ma'ud alayhi salam has reminded us of this. And that expectation is to achieve excellence, to get out of our comfort zones, to reach higher, to improve ourselves both spiritually, physically, and mentally. And as you all know, that very popular hadith, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam had said to seek knowledge even if you have to go all the way to China. So really, today, the summary of today's presentation is to reflect this Quranic verse that we need to improve ourselves constantly and to achieve excellence. And you don't have to become a doctor to do that, but promoting education, which our beloved Hazur has also been doing, and following the example of Dr. Abdus-Salam, this is the culture that we want to create in the Jamaat, especially for the youth. So, moving on from there, I would like to have, I'll introduce myself first, and then I'll have the other speakers introduce themselves. So I am an emergency physician. I was born and raised in Canada. I went to medical school at the Northern Ontario School of Medicine after I finished my undergraduate degree at Western in London. I then did my family medicine and then emergency medicine training in the University of Western Ontario in London. And now I practice in two community hospitals outside of London in Woodstock and St. Thomas. And I'm also an adjunct professor with the University of Western Ontario training emergency medicine residents. So I would like to hand it over to the next speakers. Actually, Khalid, come over here and introduce yourself, and then I'll get the ladies to introduce themselves. You can use that microphone.
Assalamualaikum. My name is Khalid Tahir. I went to York University to my undergraduate degree and then a master's degree in neuroscience at York as well. After that, I went to McMaster University for medical school training. I then went into internal medicine at McMaster, and going forward from July, I'll be working in Queen's University in Kingston for my fellowship in critical care. So that's my background. And we'll also spend a bit of time after the other talks, and I'll talk about other careers within healthcare.
Perfect. Jazakallah.
Iman and Mariam and Amna, can you introduce yourselves?
We were just going to introduce ourselves as we did our talks, inshallah, just so that people could connect the person to the talk.
Okay, go ahead. You can start then, yeah.
Okay, my name is Iman Lubani, and I'm pediatric emergency physician. I grew up in Canada. I did my undergrad at Dalhousie University, my medical school training at Western University, and then I returned to Dalhousie for my pediatric residency and returned to London, Ontario for my pediatric emergency medicine fellowships. All of that took a long time, and now I work in London, Ontario in the pediatric emerge as an assistant professor and as a clinician there. Would you like me to start? Can I start the presentation?
Yes, please.
Okay. So we thought, I think often when we do these talks, we don't start off with why people are doing medicine. We just assume that you've got your reasons, and I'm sure you do have your reasons. But I think sometimes we don't always consider what goes into making that choice. And it is an important thing to consider, first of all, for yourself, because you want to have some self-awareness. But also when you go through the interview process and the application process, it's a question that comes up many, many times. Why are you doing medicine? And as someone who's interviewed prospective candidates for a medical school, there's nothing more, you know, worrisome than someone who sits across from you and you get the sense that they have no idea why they're doing medicine or why they're applying to medicine. So this is something very important. Medical schools are very big on the idea of self-awareness and reflection. So it's something that I really encourage everybody to do. And just for yourself, Islam is very big on the idea of self-awareness and reflection. So the first slide, this is actually taken from the American Academy of Family Physicians, an article that they posted on this very topic. Why would you want to do medicine? And the first thing they started off with, which I thought was very interesting, was the idea of getting to know yourself first. So before you get to know why you want to do medicine or engineering or accounting or juggling or underwater basket weaving or whatever it is you choose to do in your life, you should know what your interests are. What are my strengths? So, you know, if my strengths lie in communication, if my strengths lie in sciences, etc., then I should find something that fits with those strengths. And then what are my weaknesses? Are these weaknesses I can overcome? Are they weaknesses that I can't overcome? And how will this affect what future path that I choose for myself? What are my values? And whatever you choose should be in line with those values. So becoming a mobster would not be in line with Islamic values, for example. Doing something like working for a bank where you are signing people up for mortgages they cannot afford likely would not align with certain Islamic values. So these are things that are important to reflect on and to always reassess. What are my goals in life and what makes me happy? So there are lots of different tools that will allow you to look at this, and the article itself mentioned a few of them. Most of you know of the online personality assessment tools that you can access. There are many. I won't name any, but you can just go online and say, personality assessment, and you'll find hundreds of them will pop up. And just kind of they'll ask you questions and they get you to reflect on what it is that you want out of life. The other thing which all of you are doing today is doing your homework. So one of the first steps I find is attending some kind of a workshop, talking to people. You don't necessarily have to attend a workshop, but talk to someone, get to know someone who's in the field you're interested in. And I think very importantly, shadow a physician. You can't really make the choice to do medicine if you don't know what it means to live the life of a physician. Volunteer at a hospital. This is actually something that I did when I was trying to get into medicine. It was very helpful because I got to know what does it mean to work in a hospital environment. If you're the kind of person who doesn't enjoy entering hospitals, well, maybe medicine's not for you. Get involved in research. This, again, is a very helpful thing. And in general, get involved in your community. We as Muslims should be volunteering. We should be going out there. We should be helping people. It's part of our religion, and it's also part of becoming a better, more well-rounded human being. So often people will think about the positives of entering medicine, but I thought I would just talk a little bit about the challenges, and this is also from that article. And some of these you'll have heard. So it's a difficult application process, and there are no guarantees that you're going to get in at the end of X number of years of undergrad and X number of dollars spent on MCAT prep courses or whatever. So that's tough. People find that very hard to deal with. The educational costs. The average, in this article, and this was a North American number, about $72,000 in average debt for per med student at graduation. Now, that meant some people had less debt if they had families who were subsidizing their education, or if they had were lucky enough to have scholarships and bursaries. And some people had much more. Up to about $200,000 was the number I saw. That's another thing that you just have to keep in mind. Time expenditure. The minimum you're going to have to put in to have a career in medicine is 10 years. No matter who you are, it's going to take you at least 10 years. There's no skipping over those years. And the maximum actually is not capped at 14. There are many sub specialties or extra training that you can do that would take you well beyond the 14-year period. It's a difficult training period. No one's going to sugarcoat that one for you. And you have responsibilities towards others. And though that, in my mind, is actually a positive, some may not view it as such. But the rewards are many, and I would say, in my mind, the rewards have far outweighed any of the challenges. And having finished my training period 3 years ago, I'm very grateful that I got through it. So what are the rewards? You can help your fellow human beings. And this is something I still remember, a fellow resident who's from the United Arab Emirates, and she was someone I really looked up to, who told me that when she was on call, being woken up in the middle of the night to take care of a child because she was doing a pediatric residency, she used to have the intention that it was for the sake of Allah, that she was doing this for the sake of God. And so that's something that really, you know, wow, you're working, you're getting paid, and you're doing something for the sake of God and getting rewarded for it. It's pretty amazing. I've since tried to adopt that, and there are times when I sense frustration or I'm tired or whatever it is, and I'm with a child who's screaming their head off, and I think to myself, you know, this is for God's sake, and it means something. There's a wide scope of practice. If you want to do clinical work, which means being a doctor in a hospital or being a doctor in an office dealing with patients, you can do that. But if you don't, if that's not your cup of tea, you don't have to. You can do research, education, administrative work at a hospital, health advocacy, or you can even do something related to governmental work. So Eric Hoskins is a physician. He's our Ontario Minister of Health right now. Lifelong learning, of course, is another one, which I love. I would not be comfortable being in a job where I stagnated and didn't get to learn. And of course, we all know it's a respected and honored profession. Even when you're at a family gathering where you're the fact that you're a physician has nothing to do with anything, people, you know, doctor or so-and-so. And financial security. And that's actually something that has come to mean more to me over the years. I didn't care very much about that when I was in medical school or residency. But once I graduated and looked around at my friends who were graduating from other career paths and having difficulty finding work, it really was eye-opening. I didn't have to worry about that. I don't have to think about whether or not I can find a job. I know I can find a job. I might have to move to find the job to another city, but I know I can. This is a very long list, and I'm not going to read all of this stuff, but I just wanted to show you what all the options are in medicine. So hopefully this will be available online, Kashif.
Yes.
Just so people don't have to take notes. Okay.
Yeah, and it'll be on YouTube as well. It'll be archived. So,
so
you can
don't
go
worry
through,
about,
time.
Yeah, there are tons of places you can find it. But these are just examples of the things that are available to you if you choose medicine. And they're so different from one another. Pathology, working in a lab, looking at specimens versus anesthesiology, working in the operating room, putting people to sleep. Cardiac surgery, dermatology, radiology, emergency medicine, family medicine, and the list goes on, and I'm just going to go through it just so that you can see. I had to put it on four separate pages. There we go. And Kashif Bhai just wanted you to see that because he wanted you to know that there are lots and lots of options and there are lots of reasons to do medicine. So you're not, when you're choosing medicine, you're not choosing one thing. There are many different, and each of these options represents a very different lifestyle, a very different way of doing things. So for example, the emergency medicine right here, which is what, right here, which is what I do, I'm a pediatric emergency physician. So that means I work full time. I work 12 to 14 days a month, which means I have 17 days a month off. Or if I choose, inshallah, when I have kids, I can work 6 to 7 days a month. And working 6 or 7 days a month, I make 2 or 3 times more than what many people will work doing working 9 to 5, 5 days a week, you know, 4 weeks a month, right? So it means a lot in terms of what your options are, in terms of what your family options are and your life options. So I've told you about all the reasons you should do medicine. I do have a list of things you should not do medicine for. I don't think doing it for your parents is the right reason. We always, as Muslims, want to please our parents and make them proud of us, and that is a great thing. But if you absolutely hate this, or it's not something that you feel you're capable of doing, you don't want to do it, you have a passion, for example, to do engineering, or you have a passion to whatever it is that you feel like you want to do, an architect, and your parents really want you to do medicine and it's something you have zero interest in, then maybe this is not for you. It shouldn't be something you do because you're stuck, you have no other options in life and you really can't think of what else to do. It's not something to do just because you want a nice car or a house. Those are not really good reasons, and they're not going to keep you happy in life. And, being marriageable, of course. For women, this can actually backfire because I know, you know, in the Arab community, for example, men are intimidated by marrying women who are in medicine. And so it's not something you should do for external reasons, really. You should choose medicine for your own internal reasons, the reasons that I mentioned before. What if you're still not sure? You've thought about all of that, you've looked at those slides, you've explored who you are, et cetera, et cetera, and you're still thinking, I'm not really sure right now. And I've met lots of people who ask me that question. It doesn't mean that medicine is not for you, it just means that you're not sure. Keep options open, explore other fields. There are so many other fields and options, both within healthcare and within other fields. And again, I think getting to know yourself will help you. And honestly, you should never be saying, I don't want to do medicine because I'm not good enough, because I can't do it, because I suck. That's just not a good mindset or a good attitude to have. If it's something you want to do, then you've got to work for it and you've got to do it. But what I don't want to see from people is something that I've actually seen a great deal, unfortunately, in the immigrant and the Muslim community, where people come up to me and say, I really want to do medicine. Okay, wonderful. What have you done so far to work towards that? I have a few Fs in some classes and I'm not really taking a full course load, which you need to apply to medicine. I don't really know anything about the MCATs. I'm just kind of sitting at home and hoping it'll happen. Nothing in life works that way. So yes, dream big, but also work for your dreams. And the famous hadith, اعقل وتوكل, tie your camel first and then rely on God. You don't just jump into the abyss and decide that it's going to work out for you. And that's it for me. And of course, my favorite doctor in the world, unfortunately, she's fictional, Dr. Mindy Lahiri. If anyone has any questions, are we addressing them now or at the end?
Q&A will be at the end.
Yeah, okay. Well, let me just set you up. How is it doing? Yeah? Okay.
Jazakallah Iman. So I'll get started. My name is Amna Ahmed. I'm one of the general internal medicine trainees in Hamilton, Ontario. So today I'll talk a little bit about the journey to medical school. I'll briefly touch upon my personal journey and then go into more details about the different components. One of the caveats that I do want to say is that when I applied to medical school, that was more than a decade ago, so a lot has changed since then. So I've gone back to do research in terms of what the new standards are. But the reality is that this presentation is meant to just touch upon the basic concepts and the components of applying to medical school that you need to. But I would highly encourage that everyone, if you're interested in doing this, you also take the time to read through some of the resources that I'll be recommending. So to get started, most of my journey sort of has been between Hamilton and London. I did my undergraduate studies in health sciences, and that was 4 years. I actually did not have any intention of going to medical school or applying to medicine until quite late into my undergraduate studies. I went into health sciences simply because I was interested in biology and chemistry and liked the curriculum of the health sciences program at MAC. But my intention all along was to do research in immunology, and it was all set up, and sort of at the last minute I decided that I wanted to do medicine. There are people that are in completely different careers and they make the decision to do medicine, and it can be challenging. For me, it was not as challenging because a lot of the core material and the educational background that I needed to apply to medical school still applied in terms of having done health sciences. I was very fortunate to get into medical school at University of Western Ontario. I actually only applied to medical schools in Ontario and did not apply anywhere else, partly because for me the preference was I wanted to stay closer to family, and if that meant not getting into medical school and doing research, that was fine with me. But my advice would be that was not a wise decision. Having heard sort of the stories from other people that have applied to medical school and how challenging it can be, I would say if you're interested in medicine, try to spread your net as far, as wide as possible. After med school in London, I decided to stay there for internal medicine residency, which was 3 years, and then I moved back to Hamilton for a fellowship in general internal medicine, so that'll be coming to an end in 2 weeks. Just sort of generic advice, and Iman has actually already gone through a lot of this. Again, I want to emphasize you have to know why you want to go into medicine. That question doesn't just come up at the time of your application. That question will come up when you're studying for Royal College. That question will come up when you're burned out. That question will come up when you have a really bad day at work. So you need to know why you want to do this. It's okay not to know what specialty in medicine you want to pursue. I went into medical school with a very open mind. I changed my mind multiple times. I actually wanted to be a pediatrician initially, did my electives in pediatrics, and then decided I wanted to do internal medicine. So it's okay to not know what type of physician you want to be.
It's probably been a mistake, though.
It's okay. You're good at taking care of kids. I'll take care of adults. It's totally okay to take lifestyle and personal reasons into consideration for choosing a career, whether you're a male or a female. Don't feel bad about, you know, whether you want to limit yourself because of certain location or medicine is not for you because of personal reasons. But the other caveat with that is, regardless of your personal lifestyle or personal reasons, there's always something in medicine that will fit your lifestyle and your personal situation. Make sure you have your family involved early on. So I'm actually glad to see that there are some parents here as well. It's a long journey. There'll be lots going on. You will be stressed. You'll be busy. It's important for your family to know what's going on. It's important for you to be able to vent to them. It's important to have them as support. And don't hesitate to get advice from others, but make sure that you understand and know your own decisions. because just remember that everyone has a different experience. Even these presentations that we're giving you today, some of the information we're giving is objective, but a lot of it is subjective. It's based on our own biased opinions, our own experiences, our own background. So take that in mind and, you know, sort of ask yourself, does that advice apply to me? And then just keep the big picture in mind. So the road ahead is a long one. There are some people that know that they want to go into medicine in high school. That's fantastic. And there are things you can definitely start doing even at that stage to help you prepare for the road ahead. If you don't know that you want to do medicine in high school, but just have a generic idea that you want to do sciences or biology or something along those lines, that's okay too. But as early as you can start, it will actually be helpful. Then there's undergraduate that I'll talk about, then we'll talk about MCAT, and then the other components I'll briefly touch upon is extracurricular activities, research opportunities, and then the medical school interview itself. So in terms of high school, I would say you definitely want to have math and sciences in terms of your educational background during your high school. But those are not in of themselves sufficient enough to sort of help you get through everything that you need to know in medicine. There are components and they're essential components, but you should also be, you know, sort of taking courses during high school also because of your interest and to have a balanced education. So in high school, I was sort of all over the place, didn't know what I wanted to do. I took art, I took philosophy, I took all kinds of interesting courses. And I think that actually helped me feel like a more balanced person and develop interest in other areas. Within the math and the sciences, there are advanced placement options at certain high schools. Our high school didn't have any of that. It was just regular math and sciences. You went through grade 11 and grade 12, and that's okay as well. I think more importantly is that during high school, you actually want to start developing good study habits. And they will come into play because the reality of medicine is you have to learn medicine, you have to study medicine. And you will need to do that from high school to undergrad to medical school to residency to any further training, and even as when you start doing clinical practice. It's not just about reading a textbook and then you know all of medicine. You will always constantly have challenges and you have to brush up on that. So develop good study habits in high school. Also develop good test-taking skills because that will come in handy. Medicine involves a lot of knowledge and therefore it also involves a lot of exams. I'm at the end of my training and yet I still have another Royal College exam to study for in September. So examinship and those skills are extremely important. So start focusing on those. Find out what works well for you, what doesn't work well for you. Start doing extracurricular activities during high school. My only advice with extracurricular activities, people sort of feel obligated to do certain things because they think it will help them get into medical school. I've interviewed lots of candidates for high school. I myself applied to high school, to med school. And my advice would be do things that you genuinely are interested in. Don't do things for the sake of thinking that, well, this will look fantastic on my resume. Yes, there are times in life where we have to just sort of suck it up and do things that are important. But I would say for extracurricular, focus on things that you're passionate about. They don't always have to be related to medicine. In fact, during an interview, people are interested in knowing what other interest in life you have, whether it's art, music, humanitarian work that you may be interested in, sports, whatever it is, just make sure you're doing it because you like it, not just for the sake of your resume. Start volunteering, and I think that's actually extremely important. Whether you can go on a trip with Humanity First, if you're not sure of other options that are available, you can volunteer locally. There's so much to do right here locally in our community. You don't necessarily have to travel to Africa and save, you know, sort of feel like you're helping build an orphanage. Most of my volunteer work was very local. I actually did most of it in Brampton, didn't really do anything else. I worked at Etobicoke Hospital for a little while just to see whether I like being in hospitals. And again, it should be something that you're interested in. Like Iman mentioned, you definitely want to expose yourself to medical settings and don't just do it for a day or so. Do it on a regular basis, do it for a semester. You can do an observership with either a family physician or you can work at the hospital on one of the weekends because you need to ask yourself, am I actually comfortable? And then the other caveat with that is if you start working the first day and it's too overwhelming and you say, oh my God, there's too many sick people, I saw a lot of suffering, I was very emotional at the end of the day, that does not necessarily mean the medicine is not the right career for you. I still have days when, you know, you just have a tough family situation or someone's passing away or certain code blues leave you sort of very emotionally drained at the end of it. That doesn't mean that medicine is not the right career for you. Medicine will be emotionally challenging. And don't hesitate to speak to, you know, guidance counselor and science teachers in high school. I actually had fantastic mentors, and even in high school, not even though I didn't want to go into medical school, they were fantastic in guiding me about research and doing in terms of undergraduate programs. I discussed, you know, whether I should go to Queens or if I should go to Mac with my biology teacher, and they were great resources because they have seen students go through this multiple times, so use them as a resource. In terms of your undergraduate, I don't have any specific advice about where you should do undergraduate. That's a very personal decision. The one advice I would say is that there are some people that will give advice that, you know, you should choose an undergraduate that's going to be very easy, that will guarantee that you'll get good marks, that will help you get into medical school. I actually don't necessarily agree with that. You have to balance your interest and what is the right undergraduate studies for you, while keeping in mind that you don't want to get into a program where, you know, your GPA will be extremely low and it will be detrimental for your medical school application. You have to find a way of balancing that, but I would say don't use the undergraduate just as a sort of a stepping stone to get into medical school, because not to sound like a pessimist, but there are a lot of people that don't get into medical school, and then you're sort of left with saying, well, I did this undergraduate and no, I haven't got into med school, what do I do now? So try to sort of find a balance between things you like and undergraduate study that you really want to do, and sort of balancing that with your marks and your GPA. And again, in undergraduate, definitely look up all the course requirements for each medical school, but also take courses that you like, that you're going to be interested in. Your undergraduate should not be just about getting into med school. There's lots of opportunity to take courses you may never get a chance to take. There's a lot of opportunity to do research in undergraduate. It can be laboratory research. It can be research with animal testing. It can be research in patients. A lot of the undergraduate programs are also linked with medical schools and faculties of medicine, so the research opportunities will be abundant, and start thinking about that early on. And again, continue your extracurriculars. Undergraduate sort of, the opportunities explode a lot more, and in fact, it can be a little bit too overwhelming. Just make sure that you don't stretch yourself too thin. I've seen a lot of students get to undergraduate and they just have so many options and they start doing a million extracurricular activities. Just make sure that you're doing enough, but not so much that you're overwhelmed. And there are some people that will also consider summer employment. Because I wanted to do research in immunology, during my second as well as third year after undergrad, I actually worked in a lab pre-projects before my thesis, because that was my plan. So you definitely have a lot of opportunities there as well. If university campus is not something you want to do in, you can consider other employment. It does not always have to be related to medicine, but it is nice to sort of see that you have work experience and you will learn important skills in terms of working with people, dealing with your employers, and those can be relevant when you actually get into working in medicine as well. So I think I would highly encourage you to have some sort of employment experience, especially if that's not the summer you're doing your MCAT. And then the MCAT itself. So MCAT has changed quite a bit since I wrote the exam. Back in our day, we did it on paper. It's computerized and it's changed a little bit. The most updated information you can get from the Association of American Medical College, and they will have details about what the MCAT has. There's basically four sections: biology and biochemical foundations of living systems, and that's why it's important for you to have at least courses in biology, both in high school as well as in undergraduate. If you did your undergraduate in something other than biology or life sciences and engineering, that's totally fine. You can still take a biology course either during your summer or even during your regular curriculum. Make sure you at least have one course, because it will help you study for the MCAT, and it is a requirement for a lot of the medical schools, and we'll talk about that a little bit later. Then there's chemical and physical foundation. So this is basically physical chemistry as well as physics. You don't have to have physics. High school physics, I think, is sufficient for the MCAT, but you definitely want to take physical chemistry or organic chemistry. Then there's psychological, social, and biological foundations of behavior, and this is a lot more emphasized now on the MCAT compared to when I applied, along with critical analysis and reasoning skills. You can look at the AAMC website for all the details, and I've left the link on my slides as well. And you can even go into each section in terms of the biological, chemical, psychological, and critical analysis to find out what exactly do they mean. There's a lot of other additional resources on this website as well. The reason why MCAT now is not just about biology and, you know, just chemistry is that eventually down the road when you're a physician, the Royal College of Physicians Surgeons of Canada has CanMeds roles. So it's not just about being a medical expert. And once you get into med school, you will become very familiar with this figure. All the curriculum, regardless of what specialty you're in, all the objectives for different rotations are actually based on these CanMed roles. So there will always be a role in terms of how to be a health advocate, how to be a professional, how to be a communicator, how to be a collaborator and manager of both resources as well as for patient settings as well. So this is the reason why MCAT is not just about medical sciences, because being a good physician is not just about having medical knowledge. And there was actually a fantastic article in the New England Journal of Medicine in 2012, before the MCAT changed, or just around the time when it was changing, was Building a Better Physician, the Case for the New MCAT. And, you know, one of their messages was that it may be as important for aspiring physicians to understand patient social, environmental, and personal characteristics in complex healthcare systems as to grasp basic biological processes. So it's not just taking care of, you know, understanding a cell or understanding how the heart functions. We're taking care of real people. We're taking care of human beings. And you have to have an understanding of how their illness and how their disease is impacting their lives. In terms of how to prepare for the MCAT and how to practice, so you can start off by just looking at the AAMC website, and I've left the link there as well. They have prep bundles that you can buy. There's also practice exams online. There's a lot of other prep courses locally. You can do the Princeton, you can do a Kaplan. I don't think there's necessarily one course that's better than the other. You sort of have to find your own way of doing it. What I ended up doing was, I think I did Princeton, if I remember correctly. I bought all the books. I went to the classes, but I actually don't learn by someone else talking and giving a lecture. That's just not my learning style, but I found the books to be very useful. So I actually studied on my own. If you like going to the courses and having someone go through a lecture on each topic, I would definitely recommend that. You just have to find your own learning style. And then I definitely did the mock MCAT exams as part of the course and bought additional mock MCATs, and I would actually practice them as real MCATs even on my own. And I think those are actually extremely important. So the courses are good because then you actually get to run mock MCATs where you go into a classroom, you actually get to practice the MCAT, get to time. Because one of the issues is not just about having the knowledge. For me, one of the struggles was actually getting used to the timing of the MCAT and being on time, and the written section especially was very challenging for me. So it was good to do sort of mock MCATs as well as practice MCATs. In terms of how to prepare for the MCAT, I actually took this slide from Dr. Ahmadiyya Naseem. She did the presentation last year, and she's just graduated from University of Toronto. And again, she highlighted some of the important things. So grade 12 physics, like we've mentioned, organic and physical chemistry, biology, and you can look at some of the courses as well. And the other thing the courses help you do is that they help you score your MCAT. So if you're doing really bad in one section and your scores are less than 10 or you're doing very poor, then you can focus a little bit more on that section. Resources that I would recommend you start looking at, whether you're in high school, undergraduate, or just apply or about to apply to medical school, is the Association of American Medical College. And they have lots of resources in terms of anywhere from people that are thinking about a career in medicine, applying to medical school. And it's essentially designed to literally navigate your journey from pre-med through residency. And they have a lot of additional resources. So take the time to visit that website. They also have sort of question and answer session. There's a few videos from people that are in medicine. They also talk about some of the finances. The only thing is this is based on the states, so not everything regarding the medical school application process may apply, but especially if you're thinking of applying to medical schools in the states, it's also useful, but the MCAT is by the AAMC, so that's why it's important to go through the website. One of the documents I would highly recommend that you read through is the AFMC, so the Association of Faculties of Medicine of Canada, admissions in 2016. They have put up their most recent document. It goes through all the components of applications for applying to medical school in Canada, and then also has a section for each medical school in all the provinces. Their requirements, their GPA requirements, course requirements, what the components of the application will be, whether they require the MCAT or not, the type of interview that they will have, whether it's just one-on-one interview or it'll be a multi-component interview. So definitely read through this document, and the link for the PDF is also in the slides. So let's say you've gotten through the MCAT, you've looked at everything, and now you're ready to apply to med school. So the Ontario Medical School application is the OMSAS. The other provinces are different. Just for the sake of time, I'm only going to go through the Ontario one, and that's the application that I'm familiar with. So go to the OMSAS website, and it's through the Ontario University's Application Center. And there's a OMSAS instruction booklet as well that you can read through. And it also has additional information about what the application will involve. And I'll go through a little bit as well. There's also an Ontario Medical School requirements information chart. This is not as detailed as the AFMC PDF document detailing all the requirements. But one of the things that I did want to highlight is you can look back to find out how many applicants applied in 2015, how many got in, the length of the years. It's just a very brief summary of all the medical schools just in Ontario, though. Get familiar with the OMSAS application sort of important dates. Just briefly, in September is when the application will open. October 1st is when everything has to be submitted. A lot of times you will not actually have your MCAT scores by the time you're submitting to the OMSAS, depending on when you wrote the MCAT. If you did your MCAT early on, you may have it available. So one of the things that was scary for me was that I was submitting my OMSAS application, everything was going in, I had put in all this effort, yet I had no idea how I did on the MCAT. And my application had already gone through, and then I got the MCAT results, and those are forwarded to OMSAS directly. So if you've written the MCAT already and you know your score, that's fine. If you don't know, then you sort of just hope and pray for the best and then go from there. And then most of the interviews will start late in December, usually after the New Year's, until March, and then May 10th is the first date of offers for admissions. So the components of the OMSAS application, obviously your transcript, so they will look at the GPA, and the GPA still is a very important component. You have to remember that, you know, thousands of people are applying to medical school. This is not to necessarily, my personal opinion is not that someone who has a higher GPA will necessarily make a better physician than someone whose GPA is slightly lower, but it is a way for people to screen your application. And the reality is that most people that are applying to medical school do have very high GPAs, and it's literally differentiating with small amounts and small percentages. And that's just the reality of when you're applying for something that's competitive and lots of people are applying, but there's few spots. The MCAT, obviously, and then the autobiographical sketch, and I'll go into more detail about that, and then your reference letters. In terms of the sketch, and this is directly from the OMSAS document, so you'll talk about your formal education, they'll ask for your employment, they'll ask for your volunteer activities, your extracurricular activities, any awards and accomplishments. And one of the things for awards is you can actually start writing all of these activities from even high school. So, you know, if there are awards that you get nominated for during high school or accomplishments, that's why, you know, hard work, even if it was early on, whether you knew that you were going to go to medical school or not, pays off, as well as research. Just make sure that you have verifiers for all activities. So people that are at the stage of high school, start keeping a document of all your extracurricular activities, who is a contact person. If I remember correctly, I think for my verifiers, I had to have their full name, I think their email address, and I can't remember if I had to have a phone number as well, but you need to have their contact info as well. For all of my verifiers before submitting my application, I actually emailed everyone and said, I'm submitting you as a verifier for this activity. Is that okay with you? The reality is for most of the application, no one has the time to sort of contact all of your verifiers and confirm that you actually did these activities. Please be honest, because you have no idea whose application or who they're going to contact to verify. So be honest and make sure that you have a verifier for all of them, and make sure you let your verifiers know. Some of the activities you may have done when you were 16 and now, you know, you're applying at the end of undergraduate and they contact the verifier and the verifier has no idea who you are. So just make sure you send reminders. Again, this is a slide from at the end. I really sort of liked it, so I just kept the same slide. For reference letter, usually you'll need three reference letters. And these really have to be strong letters because the letters are a way of differentiating one candidate from another. Most of the applications that get to medical school, everyone's done well on the MCAT, everyone has a fantastic GPA, everyone's done extracurricular, but this is where they actually get to know a little bit about you as a person. They get to hear an opinion about you from someone else and make sure that it's people that you know well. It'll be two academic letters, and this is where, you know, doing research or certain extracurricular activities will help you, because if you've been doing things throughout, it's very easy to go to that person and say, can you comment on my academic abilities, my work ethic? And for extracurricular, can you comment on how I work with as a team? And most people will know how to write reference letters, and they've been asked for reference letters. You can ask your professors, you can ask your research supervisors, your team coaches. And what I would say is, if you go to someone and you're not quite sure what sort of letter they will ask, will write for you, just say, do you think you could write me a strong letter? The last thing you want is a lukewarm letter. If they say, well, I don't know you that well, then just say, just look for someone else. Even during residency, I've read letters that are just very vague and just very sort of not very specific about the person. And to me, that's actually a red flag, because I feel like they've asked a reference letter from someone that doesn't know them either that well, or the person does not have a lot of nice things to say about this person, and that's why they kept it very vague and basic. Awards. So again, you know, you can start accumulating awards throughout high school. They may be related to either research competitions or other things that you can apply for. You can also apply for various scholarships, and I would recommend that you go to scholarshipscanada.com. Let your high school teachers know, or your undergraduate professors or research personnel know, that you're applying to medical school. During my high school, my biology and science teachers were very fantastic. They knew that I wanted to apply to a competitive undergraduate program or wanted to do research, and they actually ended up nominating me for awards that I didn't even know about. So make sure that there's someone in touch, because those are the people that will be nominating you for a lot of these awards. In terms of research, there's lots of opportunities. If you don't have a specific professor, or your undergraduate is not designed for you to necessarily allow you to have direct research projects, and that's quite rare. Most of the time you can find someone. You can also do research with heart and stroke foundations, St. Michael's, and a lot of the other hospitals in Toronto, and even in other cities, you can directly do research with them as well. So for instance, my younger sister, she's actually in teaching, but she was just interested in trying biomedical research, and it was hard to find someone as part of her undergraduate who did that. So she actually went to the Department of Pediatrics at MAC and worked with someone directly. It can be a little bit more challenging. If research is something you're having difficulty getting into, I would say get in touch with one of us, and we're more than happy to mentor you or talk to one of your professors who does academic research, because I find sometimes it's just hard to get the right opportunities, or you feel that you're hearing about research opportunities, but you're only signing up because you feel that you need to do it for your resume. And again, the same thing goes for research. Do research in things that you like, that you'll be passionate about, because you want to develop good habits early on in terms of your career. In terms of extracurriculars, do things that you like. Medical schools want to know that you're a well-balanced person, not just sort of for the sake of making medical school harder and more competitive. It's that when you have a career in medicine, you will still have families. It's very important to not just be focused on medicine. You will burn out. So it's important they want to try and get people into medicine and medical school who are able to balance life, friends, family, career, and all of these things. So these habits, although they may seem like they're all for the purpose of applying to med school, they're actually extremely important, will help you down the road. So in terms of the interviews, so let's say you've applied, your application has gone in, and alhamdulillah, you get an interview. These are my personal opinions, so, you know, they're not necessarily completely objective advice. This is just my opinion. I would recommend scheduling a morning interview, and this is completely biased. Part of the reason is I'm one of those people, I get up early in the morning. I don't want to spend the entire day waiting and saying, I have an interview at four. It's just going to eat away at you. I prefer to just get up in the morning, get there, get my interview done and over with, and then the rest of the day I can relax rather than spending hours and hours thinking about what the interview will be like. But at the same time, ask yourself, is that going to work with you? If you have to travel to another city and you can't do it the night before and trying to get there early is going to stress you out more, then maybe that's not the best strategy for you. And this is completely biased, what I'm about to say. As the person who has interviewed people, I'll be honest, although I would like to think that I was very objective, interviewers get tired as well. In the morning when you're interviewing versus compared to the, you know, the last candidate at 4 p.m., you are more tired. You have heard fantastic stories from everyone. I'd like to think I was objective with all of them, but it's hard to say. So that's the reason why I mentioned that. But, you know, if your interview is later on in the day, don't worry about it. It's not the end of the world. Do not be nervous. You know why you have wanted to do this. You've put in a lot of effort into it. I've seen fantastic candidates come to their interviews. Their applications are fabulous. And then they get so nervous that you can't actually get to know them as a person. Don't let anxiety hinder your performance. And then the flip side is I've actually had candidates who'll come in, and there's a difference between being confident and being completely full of yourself. So make sure that you are not at the spectrum of being full of yourself. Medicine is a career where you do have to make decisions, and you have to be confident about your decisions. You have to manage people, you have to manage patients, you have to communicate your decisions. So being confident is important, but medicine is a career that it humbles you every day, and it's not meant for someone who's very close-minded and thinks that they know the answer and they're the best thing that's ever happened to medicine. So be humble as well. During an interview, depending on the setup of your interview, sometimes I find that the questions are very long-winded. I remember the Western interview, we had some scenarios where it was like a 3-sentence long question. And even while I was asking the question, I was like, I don't really know what we're asking. I had to sort of pause and think about it. You're nervous. They're talking fast. You're thinking about a million things. If you don't understand a question, rather than start rambling, just take a pause and say, I'm sorry, can I clarify that? Or if they ask you a question and an answer isn't coming, take a 10-second pause and say, okay, I'm going to reflect on that for a second. The last thing you want to do is start rambling and then you go in circles. And then my last advice would be, you want to practice, and there's lots of practice questions that are available for interviews. And if anyone needs more resources, let us know. We can definitely help out with that as well. Practice the interview with your family, friends, colleagues. If you want to practice with a professor and you feel comfortable with that, that's totally fine. Make sure you don't memorize a script, because just remember, at the end of the day, the purpose of the interview is for them to see you as a person and communicate with you. If you sound like someone who's memorized a script and you sound like a robot, that's not really going to reflect well on you as a person. So have general ideas, but don't go in necessarily with the script and say, well, oh my God, they asked me something different. I don't know how to answer this. So that would be my last advice. It is a very long road. And, you know, you'll feel like it never ends. And that can be a negative thing in one way, but you also can have the other perspective that, you know, it's lifelong learning. Every day you're learning something new. Each patient teaches you something new. Each encounter teaches you something new. So it is an art, and it is a craft that you have to learn, and you commit to it lifelong, but it's a lot of fun as well. Find your own motivation, whatever it may be. One of my favorite quotes from the Holy Quran is, and I don't have the Arabic text there, is, and whosoever saves a life, it is as though he had saved all mankind. There's a lot of times in medicine when you will feel like it feels like it's futile. There's always sickness around you. You know, sometimes it feels like even though you're trying your best, and especially in internal medicine, unfortunately, we have a lot of elderly patients, you will meet a lot of patients that are just sick and dying. But just remember that it's even helping one person, it feels like as if you have saved all of mankind. And then my most important advice is, and my mom actually taught me this prayer, and I don't have the Arabic text, but it's Rabbana atina min ladunka rahmatan wa hayyi lana min amrina rashadan rabbi shrah li sadri wa yassir li amri. O our Lord, bestow on us your mercy and guide us to success in our affair. O my Lord, expand for me my chest, increase my understanding, and ease for me my task. I literally read this prayer, I think, before my MCAT, before my interview, and it just sort of was a way of calming me down. I'm actually not a very high anxiety person. I'm usually very calm and very chill, but all of this process will be stressful for you. I actually took my mom to the interview because my mom sort of just has a very calming effect on me. So lean on your family and get them involved. It's a long road. and make sure that you are taking care of yourself throughout all of this as well. And then I just have some extra slides in case questions come up regarding that. Sorry, I apologize if I went over time a little bit.
No, that's perfect. Just to remind everyone, so namaz is at 2, so we have time to do another presentation. We'll move over to Q&A. We're just going to take a short pause so we can set up the computer on the other side of the conference room, and then we'll get started in about like 2-3 minutes.
While you guys are setting up, is it okay if we just, someone just asked a question on the ladies' side, so I'm just going to relay the answer to everyone?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. So someone asked a question, how do people that have done undergraduate studies in things other than medicine, such as an English major, or whether it be arts and sciences or whatever, it may be getting into medical school? So I remember in my medical school class, we definitely had, sorry, there's a bit of an echo. We had people that had done undergraduate studies in business, engineering, music. So you don't necessarily have to have done an undergraduate studies in life sciences or biology. You do have to take the prerequisite courses. Some people knew that they wanted to do medical school and ended up taking them during their undergraduate as an elective course. Some people took it during the summer. Most people actually ended up taking it the summer after first year of undergrad or second before their MCAT. And if you go through the AFMC document, it will actually tell you the course requirements. In general, it tends to be one biology course, one chemistry. Organic chemistry is still required by some med schools, but those tend to be the only three mandatory courses. And it's more so just to make sure that you have the basic knowledge. And most people, it'll be hard to do the MCAT without having done those courses. So you can take those during the summer, you can take them during your school year as well. Yeah. And the one point that I want to emphasize is a lot of people have the misconception that if I do an undergraduate studies in English or something that's not directly medicine related, it will decrease my chances of getting into med school. I don't think that's actually true. And this converse is also not true that, you know, if I do undergraduate in, you know, health sciences at Mac, I'm guaranteed to get into med school. That's also not true. Okay.
Okay, Salakum. So as I mentioned earlier, my name is Khalid, and just a brief introduction that I had gave before. I'm starting my critical care fellowship in Queens in July. The question that we addressed towards the end of last year's presentation were with regard to people who perhaps didn't get into medical school the first time and then perhaps were thinking that medical school is not for them as well. So the purpose of this presentation is to look at alternative options or options if you apply to medical school and aren't successful the first time, which many people are not. Thousands and thousands of people apply. There are a very limited number of spots and it's very difficult to get in. I myself did not get in the first time either. So after that, you have to start considering what else do you do. Step one is to reapply. And so my agenda for this is going to be to, one, look at the factors that we should be considering when reapplying, and then second, considering other options. So in terms of reapplying, step one is, well, pray. And then after that, you have to think about what were the aspects of your application that you need to consider. Amna went through a very thorough background into what is required into an application. So you might have to take a review of what elements were in your application and what do you need to assess and perhaps try to improve in your subsequent application. In that regard, contacting any of us that are part of the AMMAC committee to review your application, to provide some insight and feedback might be valuable as well, since some of us have seen applications and have gone through the process ourselves. From there, we can learn from our mistakes, improve our application, and have a better chance the second time around. This might mean things like having other volunteer opportunities or tweaking parts of your application that perhaps can give you a better chance of success. It may mean that you have to widen your application to be all over Ontario, all over Canada, as well as considering the US and abroad. It might be an option or a time where you have to start considering new skills as well. What part of your application in terms of technical skills or volunteer work or community advocacy could you add to your application to make yourself a more appealing candidate? It's not all about GPA and not all about MCAT scores. As we can see, they have to be very well-rounded and have many other skill sets and contributions they can make. Not all of them are going to be hospital working, people work in the community and outside in research fields in medicine as well. And then after that, apply again. But even despite that, there are lots of other fields in which we can help people that aren't MDs. And many people that go into medical school, oftentimes when they're asked why, they say they want to help people. Well, that's not always a very good answer because there are many other ways you can help people and help humanity and help your fellow citizens in ways that aren't related to medicine or perhaps don't require an MD degree. And those are the fields that I had to look at today because many of these fields are very rewarding and they're also very vast and perhaps don't require as much time, can give you a lot of flexibility as well. So when considering those options, there are actually a lot of options. So just going through this list on the right side, there's nursing, and even within that, there's RN versus RPN, and there's some regional differences in what they mean in terms of their scope of practice. That's not something I'm going to delve into on this occasion. There is a new field of physician assistant programs, which is really unique and expanding in Ontario and Canada. So that's something that, you know, those that are considering going into an MD program should also have their mind open to a physician assistant program. It's those that have come out of it have had really, really good job opportunities. Other ones are dentistry, optometry, audiology, pharmacy research. There's numerous types of therapists as well as teaching opportunities and technologists. This first one I wanted to consider was physician assistants. So these are known as PAs. They practice medicine on teams with physicians, surgeons, other healthcare workers. They have many of the same responsibilities as physicians. They examine, they diagnose, and they treat patients. Their scope of practice, though, is limited. They work under a physician as opposed to independently. There are two programs in Ontario. One is at McMaster and one is at University of Toronto. They are both postgraduate degrees, so they require undergraduate degrees and then a two-year program after that. University of Toronto has requirements that where you have to have many hours of healthcare experience prior to application. To go through the specifics of the program would be a bit time-consuming, but it's all available online and very easily accessible. This is something to keep in mind because it's in Ontario, this has only recently started, and the first graduating class of physician assistants was only a couple of years ago, and they've all been, from those that I've spoken to in the field at McMaster, they've all been very happy, they've all been very well employed and found opportunities all across Ontario. As well as many physicians also want to hire them because they can help in terms of easing their workload and adding to their clinical practice. Another good option is dentistry. As opposed to medicine, which can either be focused into whatever realm the specific practitioner is in, they have a background that composes of all the basic fields of medicine. Dentistry is a lot more specific to looking at people's teeth, gums, related parts of the mouth, but they can also expand their practice in terms of if they want to go into maxillofacial surgery or periodontitis or other type of gum diseases or braces or things like that. They have a really good grasp on having a practice that can be across all ages in terms of from children all the way to adults and into a geriatric population as well. There's two programs in Ontario at Toronto and Western, and this is also a graduate program. Some of the benefits of dentistry are that it's a bit more focused as well, and I'm sure as some of the as we go into our fields, there's so much knowledge and so much scope out there that it's hard to be a master of all. And in fact, it's almost better, it's in some ways it is better to be a skilled practitioner in a much more narrow area, as that type of expert is person who is valued in a community. So Dr. Lubani would be, you know, when we have a pediatric issue, he's someone that we can go to who would know the answer to it or know how to get the answer. Similarly, if we have people that are specialists in certain areas, they're actually very valuable to every community. In these areas, they're able to have an independent practice. They have excellent work, life balance, so it's a good option to consider. The prerequisites are very similar to medicine, organic chemistry, physics, biology, but then instead of writing the MCAT, they write the dental admission test. This is a program that I learned a bit more about as a friend went into it. And this is audiology, are those that are experts in screening, assessing, treating, and managing hearing loss, as well as auditory processing and balance issues. There's two programs in Ontario and Western Ottawa. These are also graduate training. They're a bit shorter in duration. And it's a really great niche field. So what he's able to do is not just provide hearing aids, but also provide speech language pathology type issues and those that are having difficulty in speaking or hearing. He finds it to be a really rewarding field because he also works with people that are very young and watches them how they grow and how they're able to, there's a lot of link between speech and hearing. So he's able to see how people have a really profound benefit in terms of their life and their quality of life. Another associated field within medicine is pharmacy. And pharmacists in Ontario, their scope of practice is expanding as well, and now they're able to prescribe certain medications. So prescription medications to patients, as well as offering expertise in the safe use of prescriptions. They also conduct health and wellness screens, they provide immunizations, they oversee medications given to patients and provide advice on healthy lifestyles. There's two programs in Toronto, one in Toronto, one in Waterloo. These are also graduate training, and here they have to write the pharmacy college admission test. The prerequisites are very similar to medical school, but more focused on chemistry and biology. This is a field that not only would you be, one option is to be a pharmacist within, what would be Shoppers, but also much, much, much more than that. So they can have their own independent pharmacy, they can be consultants for pharmaceutical companies, they can consider research fields, so it's a very wide scope of what a basic what a pharmacist is. As with any of these fields, any advanced degree that you have is a sign that you have an underlying knowledge and expertise within a program, and you can now take that into whatever field you want. So if you have a pharmacy degree, you can take that into whatever element of pharmacy that you enjoy most. So any of these fields, you have to keep that in mind, whether it's dentistry, medicine, pharmacy, whichever one of those it is a foundation for a career that you want to establish. And you can take that into whatever direction you like. Another alternative would be optometry. In Ontario, there's only one program, Waterloo, and it's actually a very difficult program to get into. Here, they have to write the optometry admission test. Their main goals are to examine the eyes and other parts of the visual system, diagnose and treating eye problems, managing diseases and injuries. I think, a two-year program at Waterloo. Again, a very independent and excellent work-life balance. There was two new ideas that I was thinking of as well that are they're going to be very crucial going into the future. And one is genetics and genetic counseling. In the last year, we've seen a couple new technologies, CRISPR technology, as well as other technologies in terms of genetics, in terms of how vectors can be used to manipulate genes. These are going to be very, very expanding fields. The growth rate in genetics is something that is very much like the technology bubble in the late 90s, but it may not have a burst like that one did. So genetic counselors in particular are those that would assess individuals and families for risk, a variety of inherited diseases. There's two programs in Ontario, in Toronto and McGill. They're graduate programs, and what I learned about the Toronto program is very, very selective. They take 4 students per year. The McGill program is one that one of my friends is in, and that is also a very small program, I think about 6 people per year. when you complete the prerequisites in the application for that one, a goal here would be to try to have good elements of research. So elements of research as well as background in gene modification and understanding genetics. They do more than just try to assess people in terms of how their ability to have children are, or family planning or family counseling in terms of gene therapy, but also going forward in terms of, will be things like gene therapy and genetic counseling in that regard. Just a very rapidly expanding field because of the role of technology. And just as a background, when we start to think about how we analyzed the human genome, that was a project that was started in the early 90s. And by 1995, we had analyzed perhaps 3%. And people thought, well, is this even going to be possible by the year 2000? And nobody thought that you'd be able to do 97% of the remainder in 5 years. You've already taken up a third of the time. But when we looked at the accelerating growth, the last 15, 20% were done in the final months. So the pace of change in our ability to analyze based on how much faster our computing ability is and how much faster our computational power is allowed us to not just look at the human genome in full in the time that they set, but things like SARS were actually coded within 28 days of being found. And going forward, things are new diseases are being analyzed and their genetic map is being done in a matter of days. And the last one, another one that going forward is going to be, I think, in a very expanding field is orthotics and prosthesis. So this is something that if we, these would be people that are experts in designing, fabricating medical supported devices to fit patients. Those would be things like artificial limbs, arms, hands, legs, feet, braces, and other medical surgical devices. There's only one program in Ontario, George Brown. Again, just incorporating technology and medicine, this is a field with lots of growth and opportunity. If you're someone who's creative, who has a background technology, who has an understanding of engineering as well as physics and bioinformatics, this would be a great field for you. Thinking of bringing things like kinesiology and technology together. So I just wanted to open up some ideas about fields that are outside of medicine as well that have great potential to be a really rewarding career. Thank you for your time.
JazakAllah. We will now, it's about 1:30, so we'll move to Q&A. Let me just bring up a slide for those who are not here. So I gave this presentation last year where at the end when everyone discussed applying to medical school, being a doctor, why you should be a doctor, if you don't get in, what should you do? But then I said, okay, you got in, you've trained, you picked your specialty, you're working, now do you just want to go to the clinic and go home? What else can you do? And then Iman did talk about how other people are doing other interesting things, like right now our Minister of Health and our Deputy Minister of Health of Ontario are both physicians, Dr. Eric Hoskins, and I forget the second fellow's name. It's actually, Bob Bell. And then I always tell people that we have, one of our latest astronauts in Canada, Dr. David St. Jacques, was a family doctor who was chosen as our next astronaut, and he actually was chosen recently for a mission. But, for the sake of time, I actually will skip right to the Q&A period. And if we run out of questions, I'll share with you all the things that I've done. So it will be an opportunity for you to see what interesting trips and experiences you can have after you become a physician. So I'll open it up to the floor for those people who have questions. Those people who are watching via live stream, if you have any questions, you can email us at ammac@ahmadiyya.ca. The presentation today will remain on YouTube, and it will be accessible from our website, ammac.org, We also have a WhatsApp group for those people who are applying to medical school or in the process, you know, so they can ask questions, share ideas with fellow applicants. That WhatsApp group, you can basically get added to it if you just email us at our email address. So I'll ask anyone, if anyone has a question, we have a microphone up here, and I would encourage you to ask, or I'll just repeat the question. That may be easier, so then those who are watching via live stream can hear what the question is.
Sure. Sorry, Kashi, before we start the Q&A, one of our speakers, we haven't had a chance to introduce, so Dr. Maryam Sheikh isn't doing a presentation, but she is in the audience. Maryam, do you want me to just introduce you? Can I? Okay. So Dr. Maryam Sheikh is currently a general internist in Markham. She finished her internal medicine residency and fellowship at University of Toronto and did her medical school in Pakistan. I know she's been working for almost 2 years. So if anyone has specific questions about doing residency as an IMG or any specific questions regarding applications from an IMG perspective, she's also available to answer questions.
All right, jazakallah for doing that.
When is it a good idea to write the MCAT? Like, and should you write it multiple times?
Sure. So one of the questions, in case the other side didn't hear, is when is a good time to write the MCAT, and should you do it more than once? So in terms of writing the MCAT, there's a few options. Depending on the type of undergraduate that you're in, some undergraduate studies are only 3 years, some are 4 years. MCAT used to be available only once a year in the past. Now that it's computerized, it's actually available more times during the year, and I have to look up, you can go to the AAMC website, the Association of American Medical College, to look up the specific dates that are available. My advice would be that if you know you absolutely want to get into med school, it's not a bad idea to think about writing the MCAT after your first year. After your second year of undergrad, if you're in a four-year program. If you're in a three-year program, you'll be applying to medical school at the start of your third year. So that means that you can either write the MCAT during the summer of your second year, or you may need to write it during the first year after, My personal preference or recommendation would be, even though there's other times available, I never went through that experience, so I don't know what it would be like, but I would have preferred to write the MCAT during the summer when I'm not taking other undergraduate courses. There are other dates available, if I remember correctly, where you can write it earlier on, but I would recommend while you're doing the MCAT, MCAT should be the only studying that you should be doing. You can do part-time work, or I was working in the lab part-time while I was doing the MCAT. Some people have given me advice that it's not a bad idea to write the MCAT a little bit earlier, so that in the event that, God forbid, you didn't do well or you wanted to know your scores before you apply, you have an opportunity to do it again. Because whether you wrote the MCAT, you know, after your first year or your second year and then apply 2 years later, it's still valid. So if you have written the MCAT multiple times, you are asked to release all of your MCAT scores. So if the first time you did really bad and the second time you did really well, you have to submit all of your MCAT courses. You wrote it 3 times, you wrote it 5 times, you wrote it once, you have to release all the scores. And I have definitely known people who wrote the MCAT once, did terrible, did the MCAT the second time, did really well, and got into medical school. So I don't think it necessarily is a deterrent that, you know, if once you did bad and then the second time around you did really well, that they will say, well, the first time this person didn't do bad. I know people who have gotten into med school with that. Yep, so you could definitely do it after undergrad. The only requisition for MCAT is that you have to have it completed or have written it before your application. So your results have to go in around the time of your OMSAS application, and they may be a little bit after your OMSAS application, but you can do it whenever you're applying. That's totally fine. Sorry, we have a few more questions. Go ahead.
How do you prepare for the critical analysis and reasoning part?
So the the question was, how do you prepare for the critical analysis and the reasoning part? That's actually a very good question. I'm trying to think. The course material will definitely help you in some aspects. But I think the critical reasoning and the critical analysis part, the practice is actually the more important part of that rather than just the didactic knowledge. What I found was, and it used to be a little bit different when we were doing it, because you had to have the verbal reasoning was you just had to have really fast reading speed because you had paragraphs and paragraphs of things. If you're someone that reads a lot, you read the newspaper, that sort of gets you in the practice of reading things that are not medicine, because a lot of it is not actually about the content. It's about the structure of what you're reading and just being able to dissect that. And I found that for those sections, doing as many practice questions and as many mock MCATs was actually more helpful rather than sort of sitting there and trying to memorize course material, which is some of the biology or the chemistry practice is still important, but you really had to have the fundamental knowledge. The course materials are actually very good at giving you the basics of what you need to know, but for those sections, I would actually recommend extra practice. So when I did my mock MCATs, I noticed that consistently my lowest score was in verbal reasoning and the essay writing, and more so in the verbal reasoning because that you can mark yourself even. And I, towards the closer to the MCAT, I literally spent, I think, 1 weekend, I would dedicate the entire day to just practicing verbal reasoning. The more practice that you can do, the better it is for those sections, would be my advice.
Yeah. What is the required score for MCAT to get in? What is doing
good? Yeah, I mean, that's a good question. I actually don't know the answer to that. I apologize. And I can definitely look up on the AAMC website and see.
Amina, sorry, could you just have the questions repeated?
Oh, sorry,
you
I
can
apologize.
Share the microphone
I keep forgetting that. So the question was, what is the required marks on the MCAT to help you get into medical school? My understanding is there's actually no obvious cutoff because the way the MCAT is actually scored is not you got 90 out of 100. It's actually a percentile. So everyone is ranked relative to each other.
Yeah, do you mind if I answer that? Because I actually do know the answer. It changes. So the answer to that question is the MCAT requirement or cutoff actually changes every year based on the applicant pool. So if that year all the applicants got or a bunch of applicants got really high scores, the cutoff is going to be higher. If that year, you know, the applicants got lower, the cutoff is going to be lower. So I've heard this question from a lot of people and it's frustrating because you don't know ahead of time. The best way to do it is to aim for scores, like your slide mentioned, of at least 10 in each of the categories. Anything lower than 10 is very risky, but even then, there's no guarantee. And sorry, and that also goes, that's exact same answer, goes for GPA every year as well.
Khalid would just like to answer that question as well, or add to it once again.
So just a quick addition to that is that it varies by school as well. The requirements differ by each Ontario and Canadian school. For instance, some schools, for I think Toronto, you need a minimum, or it used to be that you need a minimum of 9, 9, and 9 across each, whereas McMaster didn't look at any part of your score other than the verbal reasoning section. So just keep that in mind and look, and exactly like you said, you're aiming for 10s and above, regardless of what the school requirements are. And in fact, just go for a 15.
And I don't know if someone already mentioned this, but for example, when I went to the Northern Ontario School of Medicine, their philosophy was that, you know, an MCAT was designed by the American system because the universities are very heavily because there's a private and public system like Ivy League, et cetera. And so they thought that this is the only way to really screen people who come out with a good undergrad program. But that in Canada, we have a good publicly funded education system, so it's useless in the American context, I mean, the Canadian context. So, you know, McMaster used to do this completely, Ottawa, and, you know, I'm sorry, I'm just mentioning Ontario universities, and NOSM, the Northern Ontario School of Medicine, they totally abandoned the MCAT altogether. So NOSM still doesn't require the an MCAT, and then MAC does require it, and Ottawa, I don't think, it's optional, yeah. So it's just something to keep in mind. So if you bomb the MCAT, and it's just not something you're able to do, there are options to get into medical school without actually having an MCAT, or if you didn't score well.
Some medical schools in Ottawa, they don't require an MCAT, just like Kim mentioned. So will there be another prerequisite test or like certain courses you need to take, or is it just your GPA and that's it?
Yeah, so for schools that don't require the MCAT, there's no other alternative exam or test that they require, but they will still have a lot of other components. Most of the course requirements tend to be across all the medical schools. And then obviously they'll look at your GPA. and as well as your extracurricular activities and whatnot. And if you go through that document, it will actually, there are some other schools, if I remember correctly, even out of Ontario that don't require the MCAT. I don't know if it's Calgary, don't quote me on that, I'm not 100% sure, but it will tell you, but there's no alternative exam that you have to write if you don't do the MCAT.
I'll just add, those schools that don't have MCATs, they, aside from an autobiographical sketch, their application has a lot of specific questions where you have to answer basically in short answer, maybe semi-essay format, where you, you know, about your, you know, how you think about a particular topic or your background. So they make up for it with that, but it's something you could easily explore just by going through that document that Amna was talking about.
So the question was, when they're looking at your GPA, are they looking at your GPA for all 4 years, or will they drop your GPA when it's the lowest? I'm trying to, I don't know if someone else knows the answer to that.
So you know what, I think we're getting a lot of like really good specific questions. What I can tell you about that is some schools where they will take your three highest years, and where if you're applying with only 3 years worth of marks, they'll look at every year because all you have is 3 years. But every school is different. So what I did when I was applying for medical school, when I was in first year undergrad, I knew I wanted to apply to medical school. So I went online to OMSAS and to the documents that were already mentioned by Amna. And I looked up every school. You know, I really want to go to Dalhousie. I really want to go to Western. I really want to go here. And I got very, very familiar with each and every one of their policies and each and every one of the way they did things. And every school is different. And don't be shy to call and ask if you're confused. But I would go through that document because it is kind of confusing. They've standardized some things, but a lot of things are individual to each school.
We have a question from this side.
Do American med schools have is different than Canadian med schools? Like, other than the MCAT, right? Do they have any other tests or anything?
I can't speak for our American schools, but I do know that their application system is very similar to the Canadian system. Those who use the MCAT, there's basically an MCAT, your marks, and then the interview process, and then obviously the application has separate questions. But universally in North America, the MCAT is primarily used, and this was actually the way that you could argue that the American system is what influenced the Canadian system, because there's a separate system that the British use, and that system influenced Pakistan and India, but we're primarily replicating the American system. Last year we used to get a lot of questions about applying to the Caribbean medical schools. I just want to add that, you know, if you are someone, I know people who wanted to get into medical school and they were my year. So I graduated from my undergraduate program at Western in 2006 and then medical school in 2010. They could not get into medical school. They then applied again the next year, couldn't get in. Applied again the next year, couldn't get in. They got a master's degree, they started working, and then they applied again, couldn't get in. Then this person who I knew, who was at my stage when I got to med school in 2006, the guy just got in last year. And his sister, who's 4 years younger than him, applied, and they got in the same year. He was that persistent. Others who don't want to wait that long, they apply to Caribbean, Ireland, Australia. They apply to Eastern European schools. One Ahmadiyya I know is in China. Some go back to Pakistan. They come back as IMGs, and that whole process is a separate lecture. But there are people who apply vigorously because they just absolutely want to become a physician, and they eventually do come back and start working. So there are other options, and I would say, Khalid was saying, reapply with exclamation marks. If you really want to become a physician, there are other ways of, because once you come back with a medical education, there's a system of getting into residency, which is a little bit of a challenge because you're an international medical graduate versus a Canadian medical graduate. But the only reason I brought this up is just for you to explore this topic. We don't have the time to go into that application process, but you could easily find that information online. And if you ever emailed us, I could hook you up with some people who have been through the international system and who have come back and successfully and got into residency. And obviously, that's why we have Dr. Mariam Sheikh here, who successfully got into a very competitive internal medicine program at UFT after having graduated and from medical school in Pakistan and immigrated to Canada.
We have another question. Go ahead. Sure. So the question was that if someone is in high school and has not had a chance to take high school physics despite night courses or summer courses, would we then recommend that they at least take undergraduate physics in first year? The physics itself is not necessary. The undergraduate physics is in itself is not a requirement for most medical schools. The only thing it's in order to actually do the MCAT, especially the chemical and physical section, you actually need some basic knowledge in physics. My recommendation would be I would at least take a course in physics. The only thing I have to clarify is whether you'd be allowed to take your undergraduate physics without having done physics in high school. I don't know the answer to that. I think you can. I don't think that should be in, because most of the time once you've gotten into an undergraduate program, they don't, no, you wouldn't be? Okay. Yeah, I think some of the introductory courses, like if you're not in an engineering program and you want a basic generic physics course, there are some universities that still have it available, but you would just need to look into that. But my advice would be, if possible, try to actually take it during your summer before your high school ends. That would be my advice.
I'd like to just add something in terms
Sorry, Khalid, this is going to add something else. Go ahead.
Sure.
I recommend everyone speak into the microphone.
I think these are just very specific questions to what if you can't take physics. And I was just saying, ask around in your local area. There's always a way to take certain courses that you've missed out on. But I don't think that it would be, unless you're the kind of person who picks things up on their own, it would be very difficult to get through the MCATs without physics.
I just want to add a bit of advice here, just general advice, relevant to what the question that the gentleman asked on this end as well, would be to look at the requirements across all the provinces and all the medical schools and see what they share in common. So for instance, some schools do require physics as an undergraduate requirement. Some schools do require organic chemistry and chemistry. For instance, UBC requires second year organic chemistry. If you don't take it, that's a school that's not on your list of options. It's not worth applying because you haven't hit the prerequisites to get in. So my strategy was, when I was applying, or prior to that, was to understand what all the schools across the country needed, and then fill up my undergraduate courses with all of those courses. So I didn't have an excuse of saying that, I didn't take physics, so I can't apply to Toronto or whatever school it was. If you take the courses, then you've left all your options open. You only need to get into one medical school. It doesn't matter which one. So if you keep your options open by taking all the prerequisites that are basically to cover all your options at all the schools, then you'll have the highest chance of success. Furthermore, having that physics background helps on the first section of the MCAT. When I took the MCAT, I actually hadn't taken organic chemistry, and I had to teach it to myself, which was pretty difficult. And I would recommend to those that are planning on taking it to take all the prerequisites first, for instance, for the medical schools, as well as when you're trying to take the MCAT, take biology, physics, chemistry, organic chemistry, and then very much practice verbal reasoning section, you'll have the best chance of success. After that, for the MCAT itself, just practice a lot. And I have some practice tests that I can send around. So just two pieces of advice. One would be to take all the prerequisite courses, regardless of which university you are thinking of applying to. And then in terms of MCAT application or MCAT studying, take all the prerequisites. As soon as you've done that, you're ready. Whether that's after your first year, second year, third year, once you've taken all the courses that are necessary for the MCAT, you're ready to take it. So that would be my advice.
And can I add one thing? Did I interrupt anyone on that side?
No, go ahead. I'll add something after you say something.
Okay, so I just wanted to say one other thing, because we're hearing some very good questions here, and I think what people need to keep in mind is keep working and keep asking, and this is only one step, and it's actually a very small step, to be honest with you. It's an important one, but it's a small one. I've had a lot of experience. I've been in medicine for 16 years, and in those 16 years, I've had a lot of people come up to me, Muslim and non-Muslim, and ask me, you know, what did you do? How do you do it? And I would classify those people into two groups. The first group is a serious group, and those are people who have done their research, who are working very hard, and who are doing what they can do. And those are people who I really love to help, because they're people who I know are going to go far. There's a second group that I really dislike dealing with, and that's the, here, tell me what to do, and do it for me. No one's going to do that for you. You're not going to get into medicine like that. So just make sure whenever you do something, back it up with action. So make sure that you're working hard, you're doing your part, and show the person that you're asking help from that you're putting in your work as well, because that's very important. You won't get anywhere without putting in your work. No one is going to get you into medical school. My mommy and my daddy didn't get me in. Your mommy and your daddy won't get you in. Your uncle, your whoever. No matter who they are. And I know everyone here knows that, but I just always like to put that out there, because I've had just a lot of Muslims come up to me, and I think it's kind of like I'm Arab. I think it's an Arab mentality, to be honest with you, that somebody's uncle is going to do, you know, something to get them in, and it just doesn't work.
Just to add to that, I mean, I've actually encountered that as well, when people ask me to review their application or a letter, and then they want you to edit it. They don't want just feedback. But the reason we're doing this is because one of the things that medical schools have found when they've done research is that majority of medical students, the average income of their households is over $250,000. And what that means is that kids who are getting into med school on average come from good families. Come from families who maybe already are in medicine or who are highly educated, and they don't like this. In Canada, they don't want a class system. They want people coming from different parts of the world or different parts of the country, different backgrounds, farmers, kids, etc., different demographics to enter medical school. And so the reason why those kids are getting in is because they're getting mentorship from day one. You know what I mean? It's not just, oh, beta, doctor ban jao, or beti, doctor ban jao. It's mentorship, guidance. The ins, they know people. They have a friend who's an anesthesiologist. I see them mentoring a 14-year-old high school student. They're working at their side. And so it's really, today isn't, you know, we didn't want to flood you with details. The specific questions you're asking is because, you know, by all means, ask them, send us emails. That information is on the internet. It's really to provide guidance and mentorship and motivation. Hey, we did it, you can do it. And that's how people get up in the world. When you see Dr. Abdusalam winning the Nobel Prize, he's like, I can do that. You know what I mean? Or I want to be a physics professor, or I want to go into physics. Someone to basically walk, and then you walk behind them. Of course, you have to work at it, but really without mentorship, most people, you know, if you're becoming a good basketball player, you need coaching. That's how you get into something, and that's how you become better at something. So that's why we did today's presentation. But definitely you need to work hard to get in. I'd also add that there is a lot of strategies to get into medical school. I know people who were lawyers and who were teachers, high school teachers who went to med school, never did physics, never did organic chemistry. Those people were able to get in because of the medical schools that don't require the MCAT. There are other ways. If you suck at organic chemistry or physics, and there are medical schools who don't need those requirements. Western, you know, now there are a lot of the strategies is just get high marks, do any degree. Even if it's a non-science degree, get your high GPA, apply, look like a fantastic, well-rounded individual, and you'll get in. And I've seen people do this. So there's not one way to get into medical school, and that the reason to mention that is so you don't become discouraged. People get discouraged. They look at the I know lots of people. They'll open up an MCAT prep textbook. They'll see these ridiculously hard questions on organic chemistry and physics. They close it and say, I can't do this. I'm not going to become a doctor. And that's not the mentality you should take. There are, you know, either you work through it or you take a course or you work around it and you strategize. And I just wanted to touch on that. We'll move over to a few more questions. Namaz is at 2 o'clock. A lot of people do want to go to that. Again, we have email addresses, or the email address is available, and I'll be back here doing some other stuff after Namaz. So those people who want to stay back, they can ask questions, but we can get two more questions in.
It's through that, and yeah. He'll get it to all of us.
Oh, okay.
To anybody.
They're gonna send it, or
yeah.
We have to give the email address.
If you
email
that email address,
okay.
Yeah, and you just email that address,
okay.
And you can ask whoever you want to get in contact with. If
okay.
You want a female physician, a male physician that you want to speak to.
Okay. And these presentations will also be available on YouTube.
Okay.
Heard. I just want to know if we can apply to as many med schools as possible, or there's an extra
That's a good
fee
question.
For that?
Sure. So one of the questions here was, can you apply to as many medical schools as possible? Is there a cutoff in terms of the number of schools that you can apply to? So, yeah, definitely. So there's no limitations in terms of, the only thing is, so with the OMSAS system that I put up there, that's only for Ontario. And each time there's a registration fee for the OMSAS system, and then for the other provinces, you would also have to register for their systems. There's a fee for just registering for each, and then each medical school has their own fee. If you guys go through the OMSAS document, I also put up the PDF there as well. They will have the specific fees, and then the AFMC booklet also will give you the application portal for the other medical schools that you need to apply for. So it does get expensive, but my advice would be that, you know, you're making a choice in terms of your lifelong career, and that amount of fee compared to the rewards and all the other costs that will come down the road is very small in comparison. And then just touching very briefly on finances with regards to fees, there's definitely scholarships available both in undergraduate as well as medical school that you can apply to. And you should not, this is just my personal advice, I definitely do not come from a family that was very financially well off. I have a lot of other siblings that were going through post-secondary education. I supported myself financially through med school and undergraduate. Do not let finances be a reason why you decide not to go in medicine. If you're really passionate for it, lots of people go into debt, that's fine. At the end of it, you will be able to make enough money to pay that debt off. It's worth the cost. And more importantly, there's a lot of financial assistance that's available. It may not cover all of your fees, but it will cover a good portion. So for instance, University of Western Ontario actually has a very limited number of scholarships. I think the scholarships went out to around 4 or 5 students in total with really severe financial need, or people that are married and have children and are going into medical school and also have their own families to support. Schulich scholarship is up to $20,000 per year. But obviously you have to show that you have the financial need, so don't let finances dictate applying to as many schools as possible or applying to medicine in general.
Jazakallah, we're just going to wrap up. Again, you can ask questions later. I just want to make a plug that the Ahmadiyya Muslim Medical Association of Canada has started a bursary program where we are awarding to students every year $500. You know, that can cover books. It's for those people who apply to any health-related field, including medicine, dentistry, pharmacy. And we are working with the Department of Ta'lim, who will be advertising this on their website and through Ahmadiyya Gazette. And the first application round will start next year once the bursary has been approved by Hazur, but we're just getting all the technical stuff completed, and the application will be available online, inshallah. So that's keep that in mind. Jazakallah for those who came here today, and Jazakallah for those who joined us through live stream across the country. This will be archived on YouTube using the same link. You can rewatch this, and the presentations that we did last year in PDF format will be available on our website, ammse.org, including the ones this year, and you'll be able to review this. And inshallah, this will be beneficial for your future careers. Jazakallah and assalamu alaikum, and jazakallah to all our speakers.